Many viewers found the DCC servo decoder I started to develop in video number 17 a very interesting approach. And besides a lot of positive feedback, I also received several requests for additional features. The most wanted elements people are looking for are LEDs to indicate switch statuses and other information, and local activated buttons to operate the servos and relays. For the second issue, I think I have a more flexible solution in mind that I will present in a later video. So for today, I am going to add LEDs, but not only a few, but an entire chain of individually controllable RGB LEDs. Hello YouTubers and welcome to the Internet of Toy Trains. I am Hans Tanner and here is a new episode of IoTT with fresh ideas about how to use Internet of Things components to control a model railroad layout. Let's get started! If you watched some of the videos about the CTC panel and the signaling system, you know that I like using NeoPixels instead of normal LEDs. The advantages are numerous. Most of all, the color can be selected, they can be daisy chained and connected to an Arduino with only 3 or 4 wires, and it is possible to control chains of several hundred LEDs with no problem and blistering fast. So I thought, no big deal, let's just add a WS2812 light strip to the servo decoder, provide a few functions and that's it. But after connecting a string of NeoPixels and sending some update commands to them, just the same way it worked in the CTC panel and the signaling system, the decoder stopped working altogether. It simply refused to receive any DCC commands. So I started to investigate and found a few interesting points to be considered when controlling those pixels with an Arduino Nano. To understand why the decoder stopped working, we need to have a closer look at the decoding of the DCC signal and the timing for updating the NeoPixels. Here is how the DCC signal looks like in the oscilloscope. Each bit in the stream is a square pulse with a period length depending on the value of the bit. A 1 bit is about 60 microseconds half wave and the 0 bit is at least twice as long. To decode, we measure the pulse length and determine the value. To do that, the DCC driver library is using a hardware interrupt that gets triggered at the beginning of the pulse. It then determines the duration of the just completed pulse and adds the bit to the buffer. As long as the track signal is present, this interrupt service gets executed about 5,000 times per second. Each time it happens, it takes a few microseconds to process the pulse, and in this time, any other process running on the Nano is stopped. Now, this sounds like a pretty busy interrupt service, and it is, but this is nothing compared to what's going on the NeoPixel side. Here is an image showing the signal required to send data to the NeoPixel LEDs. It is an asymmetric square wave with a total pulse length of 1.25 microseconds. The asymmetry determines the value of the bit, either 0 or 1. Yes, this is about 150 times faster than the DCC signal, and to make things worse, the timing is highly critical because of the asymmetry. To make sure that the commands are understood by the NeoPixels, we need to control the output timing with a precision of about plus minus 100 nanoseconds. With the Arduino Nano, this can only be achieved if we make sure the processor is not interrupted by other things when shipping out the NeoPixel data. And for this reason, the driver software disables all interrupts for the time it transmits. Now, updating a NeoPixel is 24 bits of information, which equals about 30 microseconds transmit time. So after about 4 or 5 pixels, we can be pretty sure that we missed a flange of the DCC signal, which messes up the entire command sequence, and this is the root cause why the decoder stopped decoding DCC commands once I started updating the pixels. So what can we do about it? One possibility is dropping the Nano and using an ESP32 instead, as I did in the signaling system. The ESP32 has more than 120 times the power of a Nano and can handle both signals at the same time. But since the servo decoder is working quite nicely, I was not interested in changing the controller. There must be another solution, and yes, There is one when looking into other types of LEDs. When comparing LED strips, we see that there are some with three wires, like the WS2812 type, but then there are also some with four wires going from pixel to pixel. What is the difference? It is the way how the pixel communication works. A three-wire interface has only one data line, and the shape of the signal, as we have seen, is such that it is self-clocking, meaning the receiver can determine the exact transmission rate from the timing of the data signal, at least as long as the rate is more or less stable. A four-wire interface, on the other hand, has a data line and a clock line. So the data bit is used to set the data signal, and then the clock signal is used to let the receiver know that the data is ready. This means the timing is not critical at all. It is possible to slow down the transmission as needed. One such LED type is the LPT6803. Another one is the WS2801. They use the same principle, but they are different in the details of the communication protocol. So they are not compatible with each other. The LPT6803 has only 5 bits color depth, which fits in 2 bytes per pixel, while the WS2801 is providing full 8-bit resolution but requiring 3 bytes for every pixel. So we have a trade-off data volume versus number of colors that can be displayed. The other important difference is the start of the sequence. The LPT6803 is using 2 0 bytes to reset the pixel chain and start a new data sequence. The WS2801, on the other hand, has no preamble bits and simply resets the data flow by pulling the data line low for a half millisecond, which means that we can slow down the flow but never pause for longer than maybe 20 or so microseconds to ensure that the chain does not reset the data communication. And just as if things are not already complicated enough, there are also significant differences in the Arduino libraries available for these two pixel types. The LPT6803 library is using a timer interrupt to ship out pixels. The timer frequency can be adjusted in order to reduce the overall processor load, but this will also increase the time it takes to update the entire pixel chain. And in any case, each bit requires one interrupt execution, which potentially can be in conflict with the interrupts caused by the DCC signal. That, I think, should not happen in theory, but I observed a few times that the updating of the pixel chain stopped for reasons I did not understand, so it might be related to concurrent interrupts. The WS2801 library is different. It sends out the data as part of the main program, which means that everything else is stopped while the pixel data ships out, except, and this is important, it can get interrupted while shipping the data, as we can see on this oscilloscope shot. As soon as the DCC interrupt happens, the pixel signal is delayed but continues after the interrupt is serviced. The gap where the clock signal is missed is about 15 microseconds long, so this will not cause any unwanted resets. This means we can ship the data and continue to receive DCC data at the same time without messing up anything. And in addition to that, the library also supports using the SPI port of the Arduino, shown on the right side, which allows shipping the data at the speed of 1 megabit per second. And what we can see is the effect of the SPI register. An interrupt caused by DCC has no immediate effect on the shipping of the pixel data, because it is the dedicated SPI register that does it. A delay only occurs once the transmission of the current byte is complete and the new byte of the data needs to be loaded into the SPI register. This documents the reduction of the workload for the Nano when using the SPI port. At a 1 MHz transmission rate, every pixel of 24 bits takes about 25 microseconds, and updating the entire chain of 50 LEDs therefore takes about 1.25 milliseconds. That's good enough for even doing some simple light effects like color fading, etc. So after all these considerations, I decided to go with WS2801 pixels, and I ordered the chain of 50 on Amazon for about $20. Here is how they look like. Quite nice. I connected them to the SPI port of my Nano. I used 5V from the Arduino, along with ground and data and clock on the middle pins of the SPI port. With all LEDs used, but not at the maximum brightness, the entire chain draws about 110 milliamps. So that's low enough for supplying it directly from the Nano, despite all the other stuff that is connected to it. Then I installed the Adafruit WS2801 library and briefly loaded the strength test example to verify that the hardware is working properly. Strength test is somewhat an extended version of the Blink program every Arduino programmer knows. It runs several sequences and colors on a pixel chain. I ran the test with the first 25 pixels of the chain in order to keep the current low enough for the Arduino to supply. Everything looked very good, and the current draw of the 25 pixels was about 300 milliamps, quite reasonable. The pixels were updating properly, in the right color, using an RGB sequence, and I could not see any flickering. Very good, and apparently stable. But I was really curious whether I would see any impact from the presence of the DCC interrupts later on, and to answer that question up front, no, I did not. The chain works very stable, no flickering at all. So let's look into the changes I did to the software. I started with the software version I published with video number 19. Developing the new functions for the LED chain took me a little longer than the acceptable length of a video. So I don't do live coding as I did in the last three episodes, but I'm going to walk you through all the new code in detail so that you can see how it works. But first, let's quickly talk about the requirements I wanted to meet with that LED chain. Here we go. First, I wanted to have up to 5 individually selectable LEDs per servo, relay or signal, freely selectable from anywhere in the chain. For relays, I want to use 3 LEDs to indicate the status. LED 1 should show red if the relay is thrown, LED 3 should show green if it is closed, and LED 2 should show blue if the coil is active. And if none of that is true, all LEDs should be dark. Then, one LED for every servo. The LED should show green or red when the servo is in an end position. And the LED should blink yellow when the servo is moving. Then, one LED for every signal, showing the current aspect stop, slow, medium or clear, and blinking when the servo is moving. Then, support of special light effects like blinking, fading and merging. And a simple way of adding new light functions, patterns as needed. Okay, that sounds like a lot of functionality. Let's have a look how I implemented it. In lines 9 and 10, I added two new libraries. The first is the driver for the WS2801 LEDs, with functions to set every pixel's color and to update the pixel chain. The second is the support for the SPI port. SPI stands for Serial Peripheral Interface. It is a serial bus intended for bidirectional communication with intelligent devices. It has two data lines for send and receive and a clock line. In our case, we only use VCC, ground, clock and MOSI, standing for Master Out Slave In, to transmit data to the first pixel in the chain. Then lines 28 to 39 have the color definitions for the LEDs. I prefer to have all definitions in one location and refer to them by name. This way, if I want to change a color later on, I only have to change one value and it changes wherever it is used. Line 41 is the duration of the on or off cycle when blinking an LED in milliseconds. Line 52 and 53 have the pin numbers for the pixel chain, but when using the SPI port, these are not needed. Line 56 has the number of pixels we are going to use. My chain is 50 pixels long and I plan on using all of them. You can specify more if you want. I don't think that 200 or 300 would be a problem if needed. Line 58 is the definition of the pixel chain. The only parameter is the number of pixels. Optional parameters are the pin numbers for clock and data in case you do not want to use the SPI port. However, using the SPI port is much more efficient compared to using other digital pins. Line 59 is a copy of the pixel buffer. I use it so that I can always know what color a particular pixel has. The only reason I need to define a copy of the pixel data is because the Adafruit driver has no function for reading the pixel value and I don't want to change the library in order to keep it upgradable. Pixel and pixel copy are then initialized in the setup functions and we see that in lines 419 to 424. All it does is setting all pixels to dark and activate the change flag to make sure they get updated directly after start of the controller. Now they are in defined state, which is off. Line 60 is a flag that indicates that the pixel chain needs to be updated. It is set by any function that makes a change to the color of any pixel and cleared every time the pixel refresh is completed. This can be seen in the loop function, lines 444 to 448. If the flag is set, the pixel chain is refreshed and the flag is cleared. Back up, lines 62 to 65, they have all the variables needed for blinking and fading of the LEDs. The blinking core functionality itself is found in the loop function in lines 433 to 442. First, we calculate the number of milliseconds since the start of the last blink cycle. The result is between 0 and blink LED interval, which is a constant. And I've set it to half a second. If it is more than that, we flip the blink flag and reset the timer, and time elapsed is set to 0. In the next step, we set the fader counter to a value proportional to time elapsed divided by cycle time. Depending on the blink flag status, we take the value or subtract it from 1. The result is a triangle function with a value floating between 0 and 1 at the same frequency like the blink flag, which can be used to dim and fade the colors. Line 67 is a type definition for the function needed to calculate LED status later on. It is just an empty header, does not even have an implementation. All we need is the type and the parameter list so that we can define our own LED activation functions. And it must be a function pointer so that we can assign specific functions later to each servo, switch or signal. Lines 87 to 91 or header definitions for such specific functions. They will be implemented a little later. For the moment, we just need to know their names. The idea is to have different LED patterns for switches, servos and signals. I also have two functions for level crossings. One using a relay as activator, the other a servo. And you can go ahead and define more functions as needed. You are already familiar with the My Servo structure starting in line 69. Compared to earlier versions, I added two new variables to it. Line 73 has a pointer to the LED process function, so here we specify the method to activate LEDs for that particular DCC address. And in line 74, we have the numbers of up to 5 LEDs in the daisy chain that can be used for this DCC address. The first LED in the chain has number 1, and the 0 indicates that no LED is to be used in this position. The definition of the servo array starts in line 93 accordingly. The third parameter now holds the pointer to the late processing function, followed by a list of up to 5 LEDs to be used for this DCC address. Note that those numbers can be in any sequence. A DCC address can use whatever LED in the chain. Of course, you should make sure that the same LED is only used once. Using the same LED twice would not destroy anything though, it just would not work as intended. So, how does the whole thing work? Let's have a look into the process locations function starting in line 362, which is called from the main loop. Here, I have added a new line, line 378, process LED. Note that it is located at the end of the for loop, which means that I first process the relay or servo and then update the LEDs for the particular address. Alternatively, I could run a second for loop at the end, meaning first processing all positions and after that all LEDs. But I like it better this way around, and it's probably also slightly more efficient. Lines 356 to 360 show that process LED function. All it does is looking up what processing function is assigned to the servo and calls it up. So all action really happens in that LED process function, which can be defined by device type. Overall, this approach gives us a lot of flexibility and it is easy to add additional functions in the future. Starting with line 125, I have defined a few helper functions, simply routines that are called over and over again. Line 125 is a function to convert individual values for red, green and blue into a 32-bit color variable that goes into the pixel. Line 133 implements the blink function, which returns a color depending on the status of the blink bit. The interesting thing here is the flexibility it offers for calling. You can call it up with just one color input, say red. In that case, it will return red if the blink flag is set and dark in the other case. If you specify a second color as input, it will not return dark, but the second color, in case the blink flag is cleared, is that second color. And if you add false as a third parameter, the phase is changed by 180 degrees. So if you have one pixel blinking red dark and the other red dark but 180 degrees changed, you have a simple level crossing blinking light with two LEDs. Line 141 is the fader function. It is similar like the blink function, but instead of returning input color or dark, it returns a value between those extremes which is proportional to that fader ramp. So it is getting brighter and darker, synchronized with the blink bit. Again, it works with two colors and can be 180 degrees the other way. Also, I am using a non-linear formula so that the human eye sees a more or less linear increase and decrease in brightness over time. The last helper function here is the set LED function starting in line 171. It verifies if the new color is different from the current color of the pixel. If so, it sets the new value to the pixel, its copy, and sets the change flag so that the pixel chain gets updated next time the loop function checks on it. Finally, the LED process function for relays, servos, and signals. Note that these are just examples to show what can be done. You may want to have completely different patterns of LED activation based on your needs. The first one is the relay function starting in line 181. For relays, I decided to use three LEDs. The first to indicate if the relay is in thrown position, the second to indicate if the coil is active, and the third LED to indicate the relay is in closed position. First, I initialize the variables for all three LEDs. Then I check if the coil is active in line 184. If so, I set LED 2 to the active color. Otherwise, I check on the position and set the corresponding LED accordingly. Finally, starting in line 193, I check for each LED if a pixel number is defined, and if so, set the pixel to that color. Here is how it looks like. The servo function starting in line 200 works exactly the same way, but only uses one LED. And if the servo is moving, I let the LED blink. So if you use the servo for something like a tortoise switch drive, it will blink yellow while the drive is moving and then showing a steady green or red once it is locked in a particular position. Here is how it looks like. The aspect function, starting in line 215, uses the current position of the servo to determine the aspect the signal is set to. It then shows the LED in the color of the aspect, either red, yellow, blinking yellow, or green. Note that I'm using the fader for the blinking yellow and not the blink function. Here we can see the output on the LEDs. The level crossing function starting in line 234 shows how those functions can be nested. It starts with calling the relay function in line 236, which already sets the first three LEDs. And then it implements an alternative blinking pattern for LEDs 4 and 5 that are assigned to that relay. Note that the blinking starts as soon as the gates start to close and remains on until the gates are fully open again. This is achieved with logic in line 238. The same goes for the second level crossing function, only that this time it's for a level crossing that is driven by a servo instead of a switch. That's all. I hope you can see the flexibility this gives and you get an idea about how the types of light effects can be generated directly out of the DCC decoder. And if this is not enough, you can simply add more LEDs to each DCC address and create new processing function yourself and assign them. The possibilities are pretty much endless. Finally, I was interested to see how the new functionality affects the performance of the decoder. So I compiled it again with the time measurement routine from video number 19, which showed that the main loop was executed about 16,000 times per second. Now, after adding the LED functionality, we are down to about 2100 executions per second. And with several LEDs with active color fading, this comes down to about 300 executions per second, and that includes shipping out color updates to the pixel chain. And as we have seen, this lower speed does not affect the decoding of the DCC commands at all, as this happens in the interrupt service. So, we do not lose any DCC commands and we update relays, servos and LEDs about every 3 milliseconds. I think that's not bad at all. Let's summarize. LED pixels with an integrated controller are much more powerful and less complicated to use compared to the traditional LEDs. There are several different types available, featuring different communication protocols and technical characteristics. Many of these types are not compatible with others. To run a pixel strip from an Arduino Nano while decoding DCC commands requires using LED pixels that have two wires for communication. Otherwise, either DCC decoding or pixel updating will not work properly. When done correctly, the Arduino Nano is powerful enough to handle the pixel string on top of the DCC decoding, even when updating the pixels frequently due to ongoing fading processes. As always, I hope the information in this video was useful or at least interesting for you. If so, please click the like button below and subscribe to the channel. I appreciate your support as well as any feedback in the comment section below. Also, check out the additional information provided in the description section. If you don't want to miss any future IoTT videos, click the bell icon and you will get notification when the next video comes out. Thanks for watching and see you next time.